And now to the city of Kharkiv, near the Russian border in northeastern Ukraine. It is majority ethnic Russian and is Ukraine's second largest city, or at least it was. Now many of its people have fled thunderous Russian airstrikes and artillery that have reduced this Ukrainian center of culture, learning, and industry to a shell of its former self. Special correspondent Jack Hewson and filmmaker Ed Rum have been in Kharkiv for more than a week, and they sent us this report. And a warning, images and accounts in this story may be upsetting.
As the war in Ukraine burns on, northeastern Kharkiv has been reduced to a smoking ruin. Building after building, crushed in by shells, peppered with shrapnel. A residential district reduced to a wasteland. Less than a mile from the front line, those that remain are dependent on volunteers like Alexander and Zoya. They bring food to those who cannot leave. But it's dangerous work. Here in Soltivka district, people fear what comes from above. The area has taken the brunt of Russia's daily shelling. Thousands have left.
She welcomes us.
For those that stay, life has moved underground.
The VIP ward.
14 people now live in this basement, hiding in fear, night and day.
Sometimes the shelling becomes so hard that the building shakes.
We got so scared, even the floor in the basement starts shaking heavily.
Did you see the totally destroyed building over here? That's how it's been.
Despite being ethnically Russian himself, Dmitry has only ironic asides for the onslaught of Russian artillery.
It's very strange how the Russians try to protect Russians in Ukraine with shelling, bombs, and so on. Better to do this in their homeland, in Russia. Before this war, as a Russian, I had absolutely no problems in Ukraine. But now I've been living in the basement for a month.
The endless booms fray the nerves, but some still risk living above ground. Even after a near miss, Vitaly remains here in his apartment. It's his only source of electricity and heat.
He said that he was smoking right in time when bomb passed.
And
he was smoking right there.
Are you not worried? And there's so many bangs around here that it could happen again.
How can I explain? We just want to stay alive.
So what happened after that? Where did he go? Has he stayed here ever since then?
We will hold on as long as it takes. There is no other way out.
Russian shells have shown little discrimination between military targets and people's homes. As a result, Kharkiv's hospitals have been swamped with civilian casualties. At least 117 children have died across Ukraine since the beginning of the conflict. Five-year-old Vladimir was almost one of them.
He was unconscious for 7 days in reanimation. But you see his legs and his back is still not so good as we would like.
Vladimir was shot in the head by unknown assailants as his family drove away from their home. He was referred for emergency treatment to Dr. Duhovsky immediately after the attack.
He received a severe open injury with the penetration of fragments into the brain, and he was taken to the hospital in serious condition. We immediately performed an operation. For the first 10 days, his condition was severe.
In the course of Vladimir's surgery, two titanium plates were used to reconstruct his skull. Outside, Vladimir's aunt and uncle appeared to be grieving. There were details of the case his father didn't want to discuss in front of his son. In the corridor, he told us why.
Because my wife, she was killed.
Vladimir is yet to learn that his mother died of gunshot wounds as they fled heavy bombardment in their home district of northern Kharkiv.
Maybe, I don't know, 500 meters from our home and our car was shot at from automatic gun. This the bullet holes, what we see, but also they go through, just through the car.
Stanislav was away on business in Kazakhstan at the time. It is unclear who shot his wife and son, perhaps nervous Ukrainian soldiers, perhaps Russian infiltrators.
Who do you blame for what happened to your wife and your son? I don't know. But what I know for sure that my wife was killed and my son is injured. And it happens because of Russians came to our land.
The man's lost his wife, his son is severely injured, and he's got to find a new place to live and somehow to survive. It's a genuinely harrowing story of loss, and one of hundreds, if not thousands, in Ukraine right now.
To avoid a similar fate, at least two-thirds of Kharkiv's population have fled. The trains continue to railroad Ukraine's displaced populations south and west, while more than 4 million have crossed out of the country. Lyubov Mikhailovna has decided it's time to go. Her village east of the city has been occupied and destroyed by Russian forces. She's been hiding in a basement for a month without gas, electricity or water.
I never thought this could happen to us. My father died on the front in World War II. My grandfather also died there, first one and the second one. And our uncle also died in the war. We thought that we will live a happy life. Our childhood was pretty nice. We never ever thought that this could happen in our lives. This is the biggest shock in our life.
Now in its second month, the exodus goes on. And until a peace settlement is reached, Ukraine's shell-shocked people will continue to pay the highest price of war. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Jack Hewson in Kharkiv, Ukraine.
Very hard to watch. And a note, our coverage of the war in Ukraine is supported by the Pulitzer Center.